Good afternoon. Thank you for everybody for coming back for the next sessions. We have two more panels to deal with before we break up, and I hope all of you were as inspired by as I was by our first gathering, quite a remarkable group of young people. In our next panel, we're going to look at the work underway and the work that will come in the years to come to create a shared island enterprise scheme. And that's currently being scoped out by Intertrade Ireland, Enterprise Ireland and Invest Northern Ireland in association with the relevant departments on both sides of the border. And it bids to grow established and emerging cross-border clusters to encourage the role of women entrepreneurs and to do everything possible to try and increase cross-border investment opportunities, especially across along the border itself, but not confined just to that. Now, our panellists for this particular part of the day are Alan McKeown, from Invest Northern Ireland, Margaret Hearty from Intertrade Ireland, and Leo Clancy from Enterprise Ireland. And if they could join me on stage now. Now, just a little bit of background. Many of you will know them, but for those who don't, and particularly for those who are watching on, Alan in Invest Northern Ireland is Executive Director of the organisation's regional business group and plays a leading role across managing the network of offices that Invest Northern Ireland has. And he has enjoyed a very wide career experience, both from working within government and within local government, and has held many a senior position. Margaret Hearty from Intertrade Ireland is Chief Executive, somebody who has been with the organisation for over 20 years and has helped many a company, big, small and large, to grow their opportunities. And there are a few people around who know more about the All-Ireland economic policy and the ecosystem that's necessary to sustain it. And then Leo Clancy is the Chief Executive of Enterprise Ireland, the state agency that helps companies in the Republic to start, to scale and to grow, and as we've seen, with increasing success. And before being appointed CEO of Enterprise Ireland, Leo was a member of the executive committee and led the technology section of IDA Ireland, one that has produced many fine fruit. So thank you all for coming, and I hope you were as inspired as all of us were by the kids that we listened to earlier. Remarkable young people and people with an amazing opportunity. Many people here will know what each of you do, but others, both here and perhaps especially watching online, will not. Could you give a quick pressé of the work that you do and particularly how it shapes into the whole cross-border agenda? Perhaps we could literally go from left to right.
Okay, well, thank you very much for the invitation, and how inspiring was the symphony and the young people telling us their perspectives on, I guess, modern life in the island. Invest Northern Ireland are the economic development agency for the north. In some respects, in simple terms, we are IDA, we are EI, and we are LEOs, all wrapped up into one, and we are responsible for growing the economy across all of the north. We support businesses from kind of early stage startup right through to growth, to scaling, to internationalisation and global dominance, of course. But we also support businesses to invest in their research, development and their innovation. In fact, in the north we're often known as the jobs agency, but almost as we have an equal amount of investment in research, development and innovation as we do in our jobs portfolio. 80% of our businesses are local, and 60% of our support goes to outside our main city. We are also the FDI agency. One of the things that we are incredibly proud of is we have 33 offices globally, and these are real landing points for businesses and for stakeholders and politicians across the globe, and they help us secure new business, both trade and FDI, which is incredibly important for us. We are about to open an office in Dublin. We hope to open that early summer. It's with Tourism NI, and that will be incredibly important for us, given that we have a micro and small and medium business economy. Often their first kind of flurry into trading outside Northern Ireland is to the south. So having this office will provide great support and assistance and access to stakeholders and to businesses and markets moving forward. So we're really looking forward to that opening. And then, of course, in the context of a modern world, we have dual market access to sell, and that's a great opportunity for us to work our way through. And politics is back, so all of this could change tomorrow. But we're really looking forward to what the next few months have. We're looking forward to working with our new minister. It's great to have Stormont back, and there are some fantastic opportunities for us working in partnership, and working in partnership with these guys as well. So that's roughly what we do.
Wonderful, wonderful. Margaret?
Oh, so good morning, everyone, and thanks, Mark. It's great to be here. Intertrade Ireland. So Intertrade Ireland is the all-Ireland and cross-border trade and business development body set up in 1999 under Strand 2 of the Good Friday Agreement, primarily to promote cross-border trade and economic cooperation between both parts of the island. So in a nutshell, we help businesses right across the island, primarily small and medium-sized businesses, to grow through cross-border exporting, through cross-border collaboration on innovation projects, working with other businesses across the island, working with academic institutions across the island, helping businesses to access investment. I suppose we're that access point, that signposter to what's available right across the island, and creating connections. From a policy perspective, we have an all-island research programme, research agenda. So we look at common policy priorities north and south, of which there are many, and then look at how can these be accelerated through north-south and all-island collaboration. So we have two very significant pieces of research underway at the moment, one looking at circular economy, opportunities that can be accelerated through north-south and all-island collaboration, and a piece of research looking at productivity levels north and south, and what can we learn from the ecosystems north and south, and how could we share that experience and knowledge to help level things up. We seed a lot of collaborations and partnerships. I see some people in the audience there. We fund the FinTech cluster, which is a cluster of the FinTech industry between Dublin and Belfast, and many other collaborations between organisations and partners who are working together help strengthen both economic growth and prosperity.
Wonderful. Thank you for that. And finally, Leo, same question to you.
So, Mark, I think you covered it. We're the agency of the Irish state that helps Irish-owned companies start, scale and grow internationally. We fund a lot of university-based technology centres, technology transfer, European funding. We also are an equity investor in companies, over $1 billion assets under management. And primarily, we have a development agenda. We help support Irish companies to grow in Ireland first and develop their proposition. We have 39 offices around the world where we help companies trade and build trade relationships with potential buyers, partners around the world. So that's us in a nutshell.
And to all three of you, where do you think we are in terms of the curve, in terms of actually developing full cross-border cooperation? I mean, you're obviously deeply involved in that, but Leo and Alan, I mean, are you at an earlier stage, and where do you see the opportunities for growth in the future?
I suppose there's room for improvement, would be the school report would say that. We have about just over 6 billion of trade north-south, so it's an incredibly important market. As I said earlier, a lot of our early stage businesses begin their journey selling to the south, so it's hugely important in terms of that learning curve. I think also in terms of the learning curve of working together, we have a very positive relationships. Some of those are in and around the shared island construct and the conversations that we're having there, but some of those are around the reality that our businesses trade north and south. They do that seamlessly. For business, the border doesn't matter, and so for us, we have to get our head around the understanding that, and also understanding how do we make the best out of those jurisdictional differences, and how do we support the businesses moving forward. So I would say that, you know, there are some really good examples. We have a large number of companies, so Almac are one that has one foot neither side of the border. Manuk literally you could probably hit a one iron and you would find the other factory, the other side of the border, and some of our food manufacturers are the same. So it's incredibly important that we support those businesses. And I think, kind of, again, with the dual market access and I think with politics back and moving forward, I think the opportunity to do more in this space is something we should grasp.
Are you getting a kind of company coming to you now exploring cross-border trade opportunities who you would never reasonably have expected pre-Brexit, for instance?
We're certainly getting more volume of that, and some and companies, I suppose, hedging and making sure that they can take the most opportunity of the market conditions. So obviously there's a lot more interest, and our recent international trade conference has helped see the number of those interests, particularly with our US special envoy. So we are very positive around the opportunities and positive about the pipeline, and it's up to us now to go in and sell, and how do we attract those businesses in. And again, I think with politics coming back, I think it will be interesting to see what happens in the landscape that helps cement those international interests.
Right. And same question to you, Margaret. I mean, do you see companies who coming to you now who you would never have expected to see before?
Yeah, I think if you put it into context, Mark, and you look back at cross-border trade, at the beginning of the signing of the Good Friday Agreement, was at about €2 billion in goods and services. In 2022, cross-border trade and goods and services had grown to €12 billion. With significant growth going both ways, both north to south and south to north. And I think that's really, really, really significant. And I think there's been something like maybe a €4 billion growth since 21 to 22. So again, very, very significant. And I think businesses are, and I suppose that's part of the role of Intertrade Ireland, is signposting the businesses to those opportunities that are available and making them aware of those opportunities. So we're seeing, a renewed appetite. But as Alan has said, business don't see borders. They see an opportunity. Our role, I think, as agencies between us, is to help businesses navigate their way to what those opportunities are. And I think the future's bright, and I think there's more of an opportunity now that we have government back up and running. And I think the Taoiseach made the point this morning that businesses need to understand the rules of trade. Now we know the rules of trade, so let's get on with it.
Some of the increase that we've had in the most recent years would have been a response by companies to the protocol, to the Windsor framework, to the flow of trade changing to cope with the regulatory changes. Is that something that it's obviously a huge advantage from the point of view of an all-Ireland economy? Does it bring any problems in terms of management?
I think it's been for a number of reasons. Yes, some of that businesses did reorientate supply chains, but it hasn't really significant impacted on like north sort of GB trade. And I think, and again, it's back to what the Taoiseach, I'm going to keep paraphrasing the Taoiseach, but we want businesses to trade in every direction, and we don't want it to be either or. And I know from our experience, we know that helping businesses that take their first step exporting on the island and across the island are more likely then to go off island. And I guess that's where the two agencies come in and help them to do that. So it's I think it's helping businesses to understand the rules of trade, and they will get on with the business of doing that.
Leo?
Yeah, I think to that last point, you know, we haven't seen any significant disruption either from changes in trade flows. I think we've benefited from the fact that that trade has adjusted itself around the new rules as fast as it has, and I think that all-island cohesion has helped us a lot. I think in the context of Shared Island today, though, I think it's a really welcome initiative, and there's some great discussions going on about how we work with this initiative more to do more. But it's an acceleration rather than a new journey. Like as Alan and Margaret have both said, we work together cohesively as it stands. One of my very first in-person meetings in this role was in July 2021, where I went to Belfast to meet the then CEO of Invest Northern Ireland, because I think it's a really important relationship to have. And Margaret, we met around the same time. So it's all about connections between people in any business, and especially in this one. And coming to a common understanding of where we can work together, what we can do more. And I think that's been incredibly to our credit. You know, we meet up now today. We're not people who don't meet very often. We're people who do meet often, yeah. who achieve a common agenda. And we have very specific things that we've done for many years together. So one specific example is Leadership for Growth. It's our flagship leadership program of the 700 largest Irish exporting companies. 350 of those companies have had someone on Leadership for Growth over the last 15 years. That's a program where we work with Invest Northern Ireland. So there are Northern Irish companies as well as Republic of Ireland companies on that program every year. And when I'm at the sessions, the sessions where the companies come together, this is CEOs of high growth companies working on the future for their companies. That mix in the room is really important. And it's the intangible actually that's really important. People from different perspectives coming together around business. And I think what we're at on this island, you know, it's almost a microcosm of what we need to achieve. There isn't anyone anywhere on the island from any community who doesn't believe that business and having good jobs for people and having a strong economy is the right thing. And I think that's a huge opportunity for some.
Okay. Could you perhaps maybe all of you explain a little more the scoping work that you're all doing with each other and in association with the Department of Enterprise, Trade and Employment and the Department for the Economy? What is that scoping work? What does it look like? What sort of outcomes are you hoping for and by what timescale?
Well, it's a sophisticated model of spreadsheets and data, and none of that actually exists at all. I think there are a number of people in the room where we get round and we talk about the challenges that we face in the north and south of the economy and those that interconnect us, and we look at what are the themes that unite the business needs. And I think we are looking at broad themes around sustainability. We're looking at themes around inclusive entrepreneurship, female entrepreneurship, and we're looking at how do we use those networks and those clusters. And I think I caught the tail end of the Taoiseach's presentation in the fireside chat, and he's talking around those issues and around how do we cluster and work together. And as Margaret has said, companies who tend to sell outside their borders then go on to sell globally. Equally, as Leo said, companies who then invest in their management and invest in their innovation, they tend to grow better, grow stronger, and stay longer. So we're looking at those themes and how can we find common opportunities across the border. And really, back to that point that Leo made, it's about the quality of those relationships that we have. Now, they are there outside Shared Island, but I think the Shared Island has created the forum through which there's a bit more of intensity of needing to work together. And I've been involved in those conversations in the way that Leo and Margaret haven't. And I would say the thing that characterises those conversations for me has been the total absence of competition, the total absence of any tension. And it's just, how do we get around the table to support businesses, to support enterprise, and to generate better prosperity and better quality jobs? And that's been the real strength in those conversations. And there are people in the room here today, in the third row back there, who have been integral to those conversations. And I think we've made some really, we've had really good fun and good conversations. Some of them have been tense. We've had, you know, those government interventions have been interesting, but they've been around navigating, and we've had to learn how to navigate systems north and south, and it's been a real learning experience. But I have to say, from my perspective, it's been good fun.
Okay, Margaret, same to you.
Yeah, I think, you know, when you think about it, we tell the businesses that we work with, you should be working collaboratively, and you should be working with other businesses and other partners, and learning and sharing and working together can bring scale and all of those different things. And it's back to that. We have common economic policy priorities north and south, the whole sustainability agenda, female entrepreneurship cluster, encouraging the growth of our clusters, our sectors on the island. And we can do so much working collaboratively. And if we bring the know-how and the knowledge from our three agencies together, which is what we did, putting the key people together in a room. And I think what's really, and hopefully what will come out of a Shared Island initiative, is that this will be additional to what's, we don't want to do more, you know, we don't want to duplicate what's there. We want to bring this to another level. And I know we have been seeding a lot of collaborations between various industry groups and businesses north and south that perhaps could look to a potential fund in the future to really scale up, and I think that's what's really exciting.
Okay, Leo?
Yeah, just to add to that, I think to add to what Margaret and Alan said, it's about finding additionality. So there's lots of great stuff that goes on today, but the dialogue about North-South is often about friction. What friction does border create? What friction do new trade rules create? And actually there's opportunities through business to help eliminate or certainly reduce some of the friction. So some of the discussions we've had around companies that are helping, startup companies potentially, that are helping people navigate having employees both sides of the border, how to manage different tax requirements and residency requirements and employment law. You know, if you can fund a company like that that solves that problem for business, that's something additional that a shared island funding could do. Not that we wouldn't help, but actually there could be accelerated help for that kind of business model. Likewise, Alan mentioned companies like Manuk and Lakeland Dairies and others where there's operation on both sides of the border, and can we show up as one agency effectively? And that's the discussion we've had. Can we show up with Invest Northern Ireland and Intertrade Ireland and have one conversation with that company about their Irish operations delivered with respect to all our agencies according to our own priorities? But one conversation, something that makes it easy for business. There is nothing business hates more than unnecessary bureaucracy, yeah. Navigating multiple agencies for effectively the same thing. So I think we have an opportunity with the Shared Island Fund to put a bit of focus on where we can really help together.
Right. But Alan, you're a senior executive in an investment agency that is unique in the world, but the offering that you can put to international companies is we can locate you in a place where you can sell into the UK and you can sell into the European Union. I mean, literally, Christmas has come and come and come again. I mean, it is an extraordinary advantage for Northern Ireland.
Yeah, but I did notice we're six offices lighter than Leo, so we'll have to go and take a note of that. I think in the session that the Taoiseach ran, he mentioned around, so I think you asked him the question around, do people get it? Do they understand it? And I think there is. Certainly our in-market experience would be people in the north absolutely get it, mm-hmm. and they get it from a whole range of angles. And I think people in the south get it. I think people in the Scotland want it. Mm-hmm. But people outside Ireland, the north and south, mm-hmm. I don't think the knowledge is quite as strong as it is for us, and I don't think it's as big an issue as it is for us. We still have to let people know where Ireland and Northern Ireland and Belfast and Derry are. And so we still have to go out and hunt and prospect for work. I think we then are in a much more stable position to sell the advantages of dual market access. And now that we've got some clarity around the rules, and I think one of the things that we worked really hard on pre-Brexit and in the run-up to it was the joint work that Intertrade and Invest did. And we were really nervous about that. We had a helpline stood up for the New Year period. We had to stand it down after 2 days. I think it got six calls. Business had fixed it, and again, the Taoiseach mentioned that. Mm-hmm. So I think we need to do a better job of translating those advantages into international markets and really crystallising what those benefits are. And there may be a few others coming out of the recent agreement of the return to Stormont that we need to just unpick as we get some more detail on those. They may complement the benefits of dual market access as well.
But Leo, you will know from your time in the IDA how valuable it is to have a Taoiseach, to have a minister going abroad, knocking on doors, yep. doing the photographs, the embassy receptions. This stuff might get bad press frequently, but it is absolutely vital in terms yep. of attracting in international business people.
It is, yeah. What were you,
well, my point is that now that we have Stormont back, yeah. Alan has the opportunity for the First and Deputy First Minister to literally do the international milk round almost.
Yeah. And I think it never stops, you know, whether minister or not, the work goes on, but certainly having a ministerial backing makes a massive difference to work in market, so it is hugely important.
I think I would add that having a kind of strong presence from the First Minister's office selling Northern Ireland has in the past been hugely influential in landing big investments and then which go on to further investments. So that's something that we will always be trying to ask for and always trying to take advantage of.
And you'd like to see them abroad and selling the wares.
Absolutely. Yeah. They're hugely positive and influential, and it makes a massive difference. So it's something that we will work hard to support and to facilitate across the globe.
Mm, okay. What message would you have, both all three of you, to companies, north and south, who are at the baby step stage, who are thinking about developing a cross-border link? What is it that they need to think about before they call you, almost, in terms of their business operations?
I think if I them in there. I think one of our, you know, both north and south, we need more exporting companies. We still are an economy that's dominated by micro and small, a lot of micro and small businesses. We know that a lot of those businesses are not exporting in any form. So in the first instance, the cross-border market is the natural first market. There are lots of support and help out there. We want businesses to think strategically in terms of what could the opportunity be. We want them to have the ambition to want to do that and then go off island with their sales. So there are lots of supports available, and I think one of the things that we can do better working together is getting that cohesive message across to, I think you said, Leo, businesses really are frustrated when they have to do touch points with many different sources. But if we can crystallise our message, and that's something that we have been talking about, that can only be good for our business.
Okay, and Leo, I mean, are you seeing smaller Irish companies, southern companies, coming to you now actually thinking about trying to find business opportunities in the north?
Yeah, there's the white paper for enterprise the government published at the end of last year, sorry, the end of the year before now, 22, targeted 2,000 new SME exporters by 2030. As Margaret said, for a lot of those exporters, you know, we would hope that those exporters would be globally exposed in terms of their exports. But the first baby step into exporting might be to make some sales in Northern Ireland, to understand what it is to do business in a different jurisdiction, different currency, different law. And we would be pointing those companies strongly at Margaret's organisation, Intertrade Ireland, as the organisation that can really help with that. And we, you know, I think that's a huge opportunity for us. And but being joined up is really important because
our previous panel were talking about the simple list, well, not simple, but a short list of things that would make a huge difference to people working on either side of the border, making it easier to get a PBS number, for instance. Is there something equivalent on the business front by one or two actions, by Stormont or by the Dublin government, that could actually simplify things for the very small companies who will get dissuaded by hurdles that probably they wouldn't be bothered about 6 months later in their growth?
Can I plug please one initiative that
absolutely
we have?
That's the opportunity.
Our trade director here in the audience. So we have just launched our Intertrade Ireland Trade Hub, and basically it tells businesses in the Republic of Ireland everything they need to know in terms of moving goods and services north to south and south to north, and also in terms of managing supply chain issues in terms of east-west as well. So that is there. I suppose what we want to do is make businesses aware that exists.
Okay.
Yeah, and go back to the reason why we're opening an office in Dublin. It's an important trade route for us, a really important destination, and having that presence will enable us to bring the expertise to those companies to kind of demystify that. Whenever businesses have got so much to think about, we're there to help them to kind of navigate those complexities and put them in contact with people who can help. And that's why I think the relationship with Margaret and the team is so important and it is so strong. So it's about doing that. But again, with those international offices, and I'm sure Leo would say the same, we can offer that service elsewhere across the globe.
We'll go to the floor in a minute, but just one question in terms of joint bids and the difficulties that would have to be overcome for all of you to be selling the island of Ireland internationally. Are there issues that would have to be navigated?
I would start on that. I might just say to your last question, Mark, I wouldn't say there's any big policy measure. I think speak to Intertrade, the Trade Hub, understand what the agenda is. To be honest, if you try and go further and make things far too easy, you're not actually getting the experience of exporting. You know, you're almost making it a common jurisdiction. The little bit of difference actually is a good thing because it makes it a proper next step.
Yeah.
You know, in terms of selling Ireland together, I think there's huge opportunity for us to do more together and show up as we're a small island on the northwest of Europe. We're inconsequential to many places. So starting to divvy up our island in terms of, well, this is this bit and you do, you know, the more we can talk about Ireland as a place to invest, the better it'll be for the overall economy, I think.
Okay. We'll go to the floor. We have a hand raised just behind you, Eva, I think. So, usual rules, if you could identify yourself, please.
Hi, yes, my name is Susie Cann, and I work between the Wheel and NICFA, the two umbrella organisations for the community and voluntary sector, doing a little bit like your trade hub, where the iCommunity shared practice hub. And I wanted to ask, after watching IBEC's Peace and Prosperity campaign last year, to highlight how important the Good Friday Belfast Agreement had been for prosperity on the island, one of the things that they spoke about was the prosperity for all, because it was not an equal prosperity. And I suppose there seems to be a growth, apparently, of B Corp in the Republic of Ireland, of, you know, triple bottom line accounting for businesses, and also the growth of social enterprise. And I just wanted to maybe pivot the conversation a little bit about the role that business has for communities in those ways, in very tangible prosperity ways, and maybe thoughts that you have, because it's part of, I think, the attraction of meaningful work and the young people that were speaking, you know, their priorities around their housing, their health, you know, all those other pieces. And so if we want to keep our own young people on the island working here, and we want to attract in workers, then presumably business has a role of, you know, helping our communities.
Okay, that's a broad-ranging question. Any of you care to tackle elements of it?
I'll start, at least. I think business has an absolutely key role, but its key role is economic return to the societies it operates in, you know, and I think business can do a lot more and does a lot more in terms of CSR type and other social involvement initiatives. But I would say the primary objective of business is to be profitable, productive, and to offer. And if it can do those things and discriminate its products, it will, by its very nature, drag up the levels of salaries and benefits for people, and that will lift the community. So I'd say my tuppence worth is, let's not lose sight with business of its primary objective, which is to generate wealth.
I would agree with that, but I agree with your perspective. Business has a huge role to play in kind of community cohesion and connectedness and giving back, and we often will see that through kind of sponsorship deals of sport or of community events. And so I think, you know, creating the foundation of strong, stable businesses who are creating kind of higher levels of pay is absolutely important for the fabric of society. But then when they start to give back, they make a huge difference in local communities, but they have to be prosperous to be able to do that.
Okay, a question from the front.
Donna Cooney, I'm a councillor, but I'm here at the Irish Environmental Network pillar. The Dublin Belfast corridor is really good, you know, where I'm on the economic development and Dublin City Council, but we're really missing. I have family in Fermanagh, and I was in Enniskillen at a lovely railway. I love railways, you know, so there was a lovely railway sort of exhibition there that's in a barber's shop. But it was to see the fact that we used to have railways that went to Enniskillen, that, you know, through Donegal and all that section, that part of Northern Ireland is disconnected to us from the railways, which I think, you know, is a real missed opportunity for us in terms of, you know, tourism and all that economic trade that could be happening if we have that. So what's your views in relation to that? Will we see a railway opening up again in Enniskillen? Thanks.
Alan, would you care to?
Well, I think you're referring to the Clocker Valley Railway that closed sometime in the 1960s. My father did his dissertation on the Clocker Valley Railway, and I was born in Enniskillen, so congratulations. I think that's beyond some of the experiences and the influences we have, but certainly our conversations with communities, local connectivity to get business out and to attract business in is a big issue, and it's something that stakeholders are asking us as an agency to say more about. And I think as politics resumes, I think it's a conversation we can have with ministers around what facilitates good, strong businesses and facilitates trade and tourism, which is incredibly important to an area like Fermanagh.
But on that point, what difference do you think the A5, once completed, will make? I mean, if we can't have a railway, if we can have proper road connectivity through that part of the island,
I mean, I think it's been referenced earlier on, you know, good quality road network is integral to the foundations of economic growth. And from somebody who used to look after a local government planning team, if you get a road like that, it opens up opportunities for new land use planning and for investment opportunities. So, you know, as an economic development agency, anything that will help get goods to market or get people into developing and growing and investing in our area would be a real positive.
Okay, I think we have time for maybe one, perhaps two questions if they're brief. So.
Hi, Michael Darcy. In the spirit of this being a forum, I support the work of IBEC, CBI, Joint Business Council, and IBEC's last year Peace and Prosperity Programme. And in fairness to panel Sue, picking up your point, IBEC has always supported the importance of dialogue, social partnership, social dialogue. As we've seen, instability can come from many sources, and investors want stability in labour markets, as well as across the border trade investment. So, Danny McCoy made a speech about this to CCBS last year, where he talked about, in the North-South context, perhaps invoking Article 19 of Strand 2, where there never was a proper civic dialogue or civic forum. So perhaps there's an opportunity for business and civic society to work together in the context of that social dialogue. And I think particularly in the wake of the re-establishment of the executive and the North-South bodies, perhaps your work can be supported, particularly in the international forum, where investors will want security in regard to labour supply, not just to support and investment and regulation. That's kind of what the thinking of IBEC is in that context, just for your information.
Okay, I think we can take one more question. So, Kevin, sorry, please.
What interests me is cross-border companies. I have a big interest due to my background on agricultural produce, in which cases certain places could be processed in the north or processed in the south despite being collected north or south. I suppose in a world where international trade has become increasingly difficult, what ways can we speed up the process on this island so that perishable goods and other goods leaving this island can get there in time in this, just-in-time market?
My experience of the food companies and the agricultural producers in the north and elsewhere is that they're very, very good at this. They have very, you know, who they're supplying requires very tight deadlines for, you know, picking and processing and delivery to market. So I think they've worked that out themselves. There is a smooth flow of produce that's being kind of added value in one jurisdiction and brought back up to the north. So Crust and Crumb, for example, is a really good example of that, and Derry Lynn, who, you know, put the pizzas together in the north, I know this because I've been there, but the sourdough base will be shot frozen in the south and brought back up again. So the companies have found the solutions for those things themselves, and, you know, milk production, Dale Farm have 30% of their milk goes south for production before it comes back and gets distributed across the UK. So I think companies have managed to work a lot of that out themselves.
Leo?
Yeah, I think we've done a lot of work in this space. So if you look in the Republic, Food Vision 2030 envisages the export value of food doubling effectively over 10 years. A lot of it through not volume, because volume of food is controversial and is unsustainable in terms of just the availability of land, but especially in the value that we're putting into food. So how is food being processed, for what markets? I think the answers are mixed. You know, there's only so far you can go with perishable goods. We know that. We are, though, right beside a bigger island that is not food self-sufficient. So it's a massive opportunity right on our doorstep. I think that we could happily service for a very long time. And then I think there's a lot of money going into freezing techniques, processing techniques. We've supported that through the capital investment scheme for food over the last couple of years, where we've deployed a lot of funding to companies to help them move up the value chain in food. Chagask is doing a huge amount of work in this sector. I think this is a huge cross-border opportunity, actually, you know, that we could see a lot more of these concepts, not about the longevity or the perishability of food, but actually about food value being added. You know, it's again another agenda that I think will resonate with the rural farming communities on both sides and maintaining their prosperity as the nature of the world changes. Okay. Margaret, you probably have a final word.
I think I would agree with echo what Alan and Leo have said. It's one of our biggest sectors on the island, and so interconnected. Our supply chains are so interconnected. North and South, I think the agri-food sector have been, are probably to the fore at finding a way to move their produce and get it off the island. And we are seeing lots of then smaller companies in the supply chains benefiting from that as well. But I think potentially there could be an interesting initiative within a potential shared island enterprise fund for that sector.
Okay, we could keep this going for quite some more time, but I'm afraid we're out of time, so we'll have to move on to our next panel. But can I thank Margaret Hearty, Alan McKeown, and Leo Clancy for a fascinating debate. Thank you very much.